organisers about the mix-up about the Clements buildings. I have to say, I've worked at the LSE now for 25 years, and I went to the wrong one and then ended up here. There are two buildings you can easily get confused, even if you know the place very well. So apologies, but at least we're starting close to time. And I think, you know, we'll still get our full run of discussion. Now, I'd like to say a few words introducing Professor Phil Scraton, who is, as you know, going to talk about the Hillsborough Inquiry. And Phil, as you all know again, is the Professor of Criminology in the Institute of Criminology and Criminal Justice at Queen's University, Belfast. Previously was for many years Professor at Liverpool Edge Hill University. Now, Phil has been a major figure in critical criminology for many years. I won't even begin to count because it would be embarrassing for him and to me. He has written or edited about a dozen books on my account, written countless papers in academic journals and edited volumes, and was a public criminologist long before the term had been coined, making many, many appearances in all parts of the general media. And in his published work, his main areas in which he's made distinguished contributions are policing, imprisonment, problems of youth and children, social inequality and marginalisation, miscarriages of justice, deaths in custody, and the politics of criminal justice and criminology. But from the start of his career, Phil Scraton has been much more than a critical academic scholar. His work since the 1980s has always probed into miscarriages of justice, and many have been brought to light through his assiduous work as a dogged, relentless, principled, and meticulous investigator. And all of these qualities underpin his work on the tragic event that we're here to discuss tonight, on the Hillsborough disaster of 1989, and the callousness, cruelty, corruption of police and other agencies in the aftermath and in the subsequent attempted cover-up, all of which are detailed in his various books on the scandal and in Hillsborough Independent Panel's report. Now, I think Phil's work on this is truly superheroic in every way and has made him a towering figure in the world of criminology. So, I hand over to Phil.
Well, that's a very, very generous and I don't think fully deserved introduction, but as we say in Liverpool, I'll take it. Thank you very much, Rob. I really do appreciate everything you said. And I also want to thank the Institute of Race Relations, the members of which, the staff of which I've known for so many years, and who themselves have made such a massive contribution to issues around injustice in the areas of race and class and structural inequality. And to have the opportunity to write the first piece after the independent report of the panel the current edition of Race and Class was a great privilege and honour, and I'm so pleased to have published it there rather than in any other journal because of their dedication. The other thanks I have is to the Mannheim Centre and to the London School of Economics for hosting this event, and it demonstrates, I believe, the role of academic work in public debate, the right in the centre of the city, we can have a session such as this. And thank you all very much for coming. I'm also going to thank all of the family members who are here from the various campaigns, specifically from Hillsborough, Margaret Aspinall, who is the chair of the Hillsborough Family Support Group, and Sue Roberts, who is the secretary of the Hillsborough Family Support Group, without whom, without the Hillsborough Family Support Group, none of us would be here this evening, and I'll be explaining why. I think that we now see this phrase in so many different places, and of course its origins go back well before Ariel Dorfman wrote his wonderful play and account of speaking truth to power. But I want to put a spin on it that is absolutely clear for the work that I do, the work that my colleagues do, and specifically in relation to Hillsborough. Has it become just a simple slogan? I would say no. I would say to speak truth to power is an exhortation. It's something that speaks out to all of us. It's something that makes a demand on all of us, not just to sit in rooms and debate and discuss and to wring our hands, but to actually engage directly and bear witness. In much of the work that I've written more recently, I use this other phrase, which too has become sloganized, but bearing witness to me is absolutely central. When I find a 16-year-old young woman, still a child in the UN Convention of the Rights of the Child definition, when I find her in a strip cell in McGabbery Prison in the north of Ireland, and she's there because she self-harms, and she is cut from her ankles to her hips, from her wrists to her shoulders, that's the moment at which, as a critical analyst, as a researcher, I bear witness. It's my role, it's my responsibility, not to think about academic work in that moment, but to think about what is being done in our name, what is being done in the state's name. To hear testimonies, to gather those testimonies, and to present those testimonies as part of that process of bearing witness, and of course, to recover truth. Truth recovery has never been more significant than it is in the moment. One of the reasons that I work and live in Belfast is because truth recovery is so significant at this particular moment in time, not least because the war is semi-over and therefore we don't talk any longer about the conflict. But the legacy of the conflict lives on, and it lives on in the lives of the children and young people who are experiencing transgenerational trauma, who are being handed down the issues that are the legacy of that conflict. And we need to recover truth in order to make sense of the present, in order to build the future. But also in this work, we should have no illusions about the deceit that is told to us by those in power, the deceit that is not only structural and deliberate and conspiratorial, but the deceit that is subtle, the deceit that actually is slightly beneath the surface, that becomes part of the processes that we actually operate within. And none of this would make any sense whatsoever if we weren't engaged in hearing the view from below. And I'm not using that in any kind of a condescending way. The view from below, from me, is the view from those who directly are involved in the suffering and the pain of the kinds of issues that we're talking about. Some of those families are here tonight from a range of different campaigns, and those are the people who really do understand. And when we say we understand your pain and suffering, no, we don't. We might be able to interpret, we might be able to bear witness to it, we might be able to uncover it, but we don't understand it. We don't feel it in the way in which they do. That, for me, is the view from below. That's where the incontrovertible truth actually lies. It lies in Eddie Spirit, whose son died in his arms at Hillsborough, and there he was in Pen 4, going into the ground, waiting at the back because he didn't want to go into the stadium. He knew that there was a massive crush outside. He stood back with his 14-year-old son, Adam, and when Gate C opened and the police called people through, he went down the tunnel, I will talk about this in a second, into the back of the pens. He went into Pen 4. He found a way down to close near the front. And then the crush came. It wasn't a surge. It was like a vice getting tighter and tighter. I turned Adam round to me. He was obviously in distress. there was a police officer about 5 or 6 feet away, and I started begging him to open the gate. I was actually screaming. Adam had fainted, and my actual words were, "My lovely son is dying," and begging him to help me, and he didn't do anything. He just stood there and he looked at me. I grabbed hold of Adam. He had a tracksuit on, and I grabbed hold of his lapels, and I tried to lift him over the fence, and the fence is 10 feet thereabouts with spikes coming in. I couldn't lift him. So then I started punching the fence in the hope I would punch it down. Right at the beginning, when I was begging the officer to open the gate, if he would have opened it, I could have got Adam out. And then comes the word that every survivor, those of you who are survivors who are here tonight, know only too well. I know that because I was there. And when I first sat with Eddie and his wife, Jan, in their house and interviewed him for 5 hours way back when, and we talked through these issues, that was a moment when everything that I suspected about the problems at Hillsborough came into real clarity. Very briefly, people arrived that day, the 15th of April, beautiful summer, early spring day, snow still on the Pennines as people drove over, very warm. People arrived in Sheffield. It was a neutral ground. Liverpool were playing Nottingham Forest. It was a semi-final of the FA Cup, a repeat of the previous year's semi-final. People were happy. This was a great moment. Liverpool were doing very well as a football team. The supporters were used to success. They arrived in coaches and trains and in private cars. The coaches were stopped and searched en route. They were stopped and searched again when they were parked up. The fans were met by the police at the coach parks. The phrase that's used at that time is that they were corralled. They were taken and escorted to the stadium in numbers. The Leppings Lane end of the ground where Liverpool fans were brought to had no filtering as you arrived at the outside of the ground, at the outer concourse. The crush built at the turnstiles, a massive wall to one side, a river to the other. 25,000 people condensed into this area to go into the north stand, into the Leppings Lane stand and onto the terrace, where 10,100 people were licensed to actually stand. The crush was so great, the senior officer pleaded to open the exit gates, and an exit gate was opened. Fans entered and stewarded. They went straight ahead, and right in front of them, there it was, standing, a word. Two open gates. They went straight through. They didn't know the ground. They didn't know how the ground operated. They just went down. And that was where the crush began. As they went down and went into already overcrowded pens, that was what Eddie was telling us. It wasn't a surge. It was a crush getting tighter and tighter. The compression caused a barrier at the front of pen 3 to collapse. Bodies went down, piled high on top of each other. The police, as Eddie says, refused to open the small perimeter gates at the front of each pen. Fans who were trying to climb out were pushed back in. There was an inadequate emergency and medical response. This is what it kind of looks like. That's the area outside where the build-up is, and you can see 25,000 people going into an area no bigger than an average-sized school playground to those turnstiles to feed into the pens down here and then above for the Leppings Lane stand and then to the north stand. That was where they had to come down under this stand at the west end through the tunnel into pens 3 and 4. That's what it looked like at 10 to 3. Or no, that's what it looked like at just after 3. Bruce Grobbelaar is in the goal. And here you can see the absolute packed, tight pens in the centre. And on the sides, people could sit on the steps. There had been no stewarding. In actual fact, we always thought for so many years there were twice as many fans in those pens than there should have been. But in fact, latterly, we've discovered that it was 4 times as many as there should have been. And all this right literally under the noses of the senior police officers who were administering the game. Just below that notice board there, you'll see to the left a small blue cabin. That cabin houses Chief Superintendent Duckenfield, Superintendent Murray. They are in charge of the fixture. They have a barrage of screens around them. They can see all that is happening in the pens with their eyes. They can see outside through the monitors of what the build-up on the outside concourse. A few minutes later, as you can see, people now are so compressed, they're beginning to climb the fence. Some are managing to get out through the two small gates. The gates are no wider than my shoulders. And at the front of Pen 3, where the most dense crowd is, the bodies are 17 deep. People are just about coming out. The game is still on. Bruce Grobbelaar is still in his goal. This is the moment. This is the moment when people are at the point of no return. The blunt truth, says Chief Superintendent Duckenfield afterwards, that we'd been asked to open a gate. I was not being deceitful, he says. We were all in a state of shock. I just thought at that stage I should not communicate fully the situation. I may have misled Mr. Kelly. What is he talking about? He's stating that in the immediate moment, as we are watching that unfold, Graham Kelly from the Football Association goes to the box. He says, what on earth is going on? Chief Superintendent Duckenfield, despite all the evidence on his monitors, despite him ordering the opening of Gate C, despite knowing precisely what the order and sequence of events were, stated quite categorically to Graham Kelly that the fans had rushed the stadium, they'd broken down an exit gate and forced entry and stampeded down the tunnel. That was the lie. That was the lie that actually laid heavy on the immediate media response. I may have misled Mr. Kelly. He did. And Kelly repeated Duckenfield's lie to the waiting media. Within minutes, it was broadcast around the world. An appalling disaster was happening, and Liverpool fans were blamed. This was the second semi-final that I had actually missed. My children were very young. I was upstairs working on a book on prisons, actually, when our Paul came running up the stairs and said, Dad, you've got to come down, see what's happening at Hillsborough. I said, Son, there is no way. It's not on television. He said, it is now. It was in the middle of the snooker championships, also in Sheffield, and they'd interrupted. Already at this moment, in those broadcasts, Liverpool fans were being blamed because of that lie. And of course, within a day, Jacques Georges, the FIFA president, he states they were like beasts waiting to charge into the arena. Yeah, of course, this was the language of soccer-related violence of the time. Animals, beasts. And kind of it has a parallel to putting people in cages, to putting football fans actually in pens. Who do we pen? We pen animals. And that was the mentality of the time. This was an easy statement for Jacques Georges to make. And how then does the lie consolidate? This picture tells the whole story. It's the next day. One of the things when you look at it is, I think you'd probably be surprised, is just how small the pens are. How could 96 people die in such a small area? And here Margaret Thatcher is being briefed. And yes, there's the chief constable. There's Bernard Ingram, her press secretary. There is Hurd, Douglas Hurd, her home secretary. There is the club secretary, Mackrell, and surrounded by senior police officers, including David Duckenfield. This was when Margaret Thatcher learned for the first time within 24 hours that Hillsborough had been caused by a mob tanked up on drink. How do we know that? How do we know what that conversation contained? Because Bernard Ingram is indiscreet. This was his letter when we challenged him. I visited Hillsborough on the morning after the disaster. I know what I learned on the spot. There would have been no Hillsborough if a mob, who were clearly tanked up, had not tried to force their way into the ground. To blame the police is a cop-out. I see no purpose in addressing an organisation, meaning here, the family's support group, which is incapable of accepting the simple fact. I know what I learned on the spot. So already we can see a pattern emerging as the lie consolidates. The coroner, Stephen Popper, the pathologist, one of the leading pathologists of his generation, Alan Usher, they arrive together about 6 o'clock in the evening while the bodies are being put in body bags in the gymnasium. What does the coroner decide to do that is completely unprecedented in the history of disasters? To take the blood alcohol levels of all who died, including the children. Where does that information come from? How is it at 6 o'clock that he is being informed that that alcohol could have played a major part? Never happened before, never since. Yes, you take blood alcohol of train drivers in crashes, you take blood alcohol of pilots in crashes, etc., people who are actually in a role of direct responsibility. It was because, as Proper later said, I considered it might have played a significant part in Hillsborough. But what fed him that information? He hadn't been at the ground. He hadn't seen it. He was briefed when he arrived by the head of CID, who was actually in charge of the inquiry at that moment. The South Yorkshire Police briefing. I don't think it would be right now to be talking about the animalistic behaviour of fans, the level of drink. Whoever is looking at it overall will find that out without any problem. This is within 24 hours, a document that has since come to light. This was the briefing that Peter Wright, who was the chief constable of South Yorkshire, was actually making. And of course, the media were briefed instantly that the fans were drunk, they were ticketless, they'd arrived without tickets to force entry, they were abusive, they were violent. Of course, the phrase that was used was hooligans. And even Brian Clough later stated, as Nottingham Forest manager who was there, but who had no evidence to make this statement, Liverpool fans were killed by Liverpool people, holding the victims and the survivors to account. And of course, the lie was broadcast within days. This is the infamous front page, Kelvin McKenzie, the truth. Some fans pick pockets of victims, some fans urinated on the brave cops, some fans beat up PC giving his life. Note the lack of parenthesis. This is a statement of fact. He also adds on his next page that a woman was sexually assaulted by fans. This was in days. This was what the families who had not yet received the bodies of their loved ones back were hearing in the Sun. The Sun has hardly been sold in Liverpool since. Kelvin McKenzie has made an apology, then retracted, made an apology, then retracted, made an apology, now, finally, but says that he was misled. But let's just hang on a second. Let's look at the newspapers of that day. These are just headlines from other of the newspapers. Dead fans robbed by drunk thugs. Vile fans fought us as we tried to help the dying. Police accused drunken fans. Sick spectacle of pilfering from the dying. Liverpool pickpockets pounced on the dead. Yobbed sex jibes over girls' corpse. Heavy drinking fans besieged the ground. In other words, although the greatest opprobrium is levelled at the Sun and Kelvin McKenzie, it was a successful process of manipulating the news media, because these are the headlines taken from six other newspapers, and there are another eight besides these. Of course, what follows is the classic response. A judicial inquiry conducted within the remit of the Home Office by Lord Justice Taylor. Of course, this is the Lord Justice Taylor, who was the prosecutor in the Stephen Kisco case. I won't say any more. If you don't know about that, Google it. The judicial inquiry set up under Lord Justice Taylor, he was actually chosen because he was a football supporter himself, and it was thought that he would bring a level of understanding to the whole process, which he did. Criminal investigation and disciplinary investigation going on, juxtaposed by the West Midlands Police. Incredible choice, the West Midlands Police. Their whole serious crime squad was actually suspended and under investigation at the moment they were brought in to investigate Hillsborough. Beachy, who is one of their leading lights in that suspension, is actually seconded to this inquiry. And still, the fallout from that goes on. The inquests, both individual and generic hearings. They held individual inquests up to 8 a day over a period of time, just so that they stated they would give some solace to the families. But none of that evidence that was presented was questionable. None of it was examined because it was given in the third party by West Midlands police officers on behalf of the witnesses. Then, later, after the decision was taken not to criminally prosecute, generic hearings were held with many, many witnesses called to actually look at Hillsborough generically. Of course, it was a problem right from the outset, and one that I opposed in verbally and also in writing at the time. Whereas Lord Justice Taylor had said that the main reason, the main cause of the disaster was overcrowding, and the main reason was lack of police control of the crowd, which gave some satisfaction to families to know that their loved ones were not being blamed. That was turned on its head by the inquest verdicts in all 95, as it was at that time, because Tony Bland was on a life support machine. The actual response and conclusion and verdict was accidental death. I'm not going to go into the technical aspects of why it was accidental death, because, to put it mildly, it wasn't considered that the negligence that existed, which they did identify, the negligence that existed, was of sufficient magnitude to reach a verdict of unlawfully killed. At the same time, civil actions were running. The judicial review was then mounted of the inquests. That led to nothing. It got as far as the High Court, but was knocked back. And then, after the Labour government is returned in June 1997, Jack Straw appoints a judicial scrutiny under former MI6 Commissioner Lord Justice Stuart-Smith. Perhaps not the most sensitive choice of a justice to head up a judicial scrutiny of evidence, and I'll be dealing with that in a second. 2000, surprising everybody, the families took a private prosecution against David Duckenfield and Bernard Murray. Bernard Murray was acquitted after a 7 weeks trial, and the judge was demonstrably shocked that it went the full length. He was acquitted, and David Duckenfield, it was a hung jury, and the decision was taken by Justice Morland that there would be no further action taken. There was no retrial. That ended it. The Hillsborough Project was founded in the immediate aftermath of Hillsborough, and myself and three other researchers were funded by Liverpool City Council. We produced our first report, lengthy report, in 1990, Hillsborough and After, which not only identified the issues around the disaster itself, but also demonstrated the appalling treatment that the families had received in going to identify their loved ones on the evening of the disaster and the next morning. That was the first real attempt to tell a different story. By 1995, when we produced No Last Rights, rights spelled R-I-G-H-T-S, we examined in depth the coronial process, and we demonstrated absolutely clearly its failings from beginning to end at every stage. We also, in that work, demonstrated the role and manipulation of the media. Immediately after that, Jimmy McGovern's film was broadcast nationally, internationally. 53 different countries took it, Hillsborough, following the lives of four families and what they went through in the immediate aftermath as a microcosm of the Hillsborough families and their suffering. That process gathered a head of steam. And as I said, when the Labour government came into power, Jack Straw, as Home Secretary, was under tremendous pressure. One of the reasons for that was that in 1996 to 1997, I identified a former South Yorkshire police officer. I came home from work one night, having been teaching on my master's course, and you know when you're flicking through the channels and you land on a programme and you think, oh, this seems interesting, and then you move on to another. Well, this one did seem interesting because the guy, long blonde hair, picture of the terrace behind him, was recounting his story as a police officer at Hillsborough. This had never happened before. And the words he used was sanitising the evidence. Coming from a police officer who had clearly broken ranks and who now was clearly a former South Yorkshire police officer, this was dynamic. It took me months to contact him, to find him, without trying to put him under pressure because I knew he'd been stressed. I left my name, my address with him. And then I met him on three separate occasions. We walked the hills above Hathersage in Sheffield. He told me a story. And on the last day, the last occasion we met, he left me sitting in a cafe and he went to his car and he came back with a box file. He said, this is for you. To now, it had all been hearsay. To now, it had all been his account. He'd had two breakdowns. His marriage had collapsed. He hardly saw his children. He was incredibly distressed. He would have been a witness that would have been taken apart in any court. But the box file was different. The box file demonstrated clearly that 53 of the sentences from his original statement had been removed, that the statements had been reviewed and altered. These were not my words. They were the words contained on the front memorandum from the senior partner in Hammond Soddarts, one of the biggest firms in the north of England, to the chief superintendent in charge of the investigation, David Denton, in the South Yorkshire Police. Any statements that have not been edited will not be subject to review and alteration. Now I had the words. They weren't my words. They were the words of the process. The process was conducted then by South Yorkshire Police internally, but those altered statements now had a life. They went to the West Midlands Police investigators, who adopted them willingly. They went to the Taylor Inquiry, who incredibly adopted them willingly. And they went to the coroner, who also adopted them willingly. These became the statements of truth to all of those investigations. And they were essentially flawed. When Stuart Smith was called in to actually review the evidence by Jack Straw years later, following the process of disclosure, at that point, the only statement I'd seen, the only front piece that I had seen, had come from David Frost's statement. When Stuart Smith's scrutiny of evidence came, that was the evidence I was banking on. He was appointed on the 30th of June, 97, and he reported in February, 98. And of all of the issues that he dealt with, and he met 17 or 18 of the families in Liverpool, he spoke to all of the families in Liverpool in what was a disastrous meeting. But in that time, what I was concerned about emphasising was this one case of review and alteration of the statement. And he went in to the altered statements. He said, over 100 sampled statements. And he stated quite clearly, in my opinion, the allegation made by Professor Scraton of irregularity and malpractice is not substantiated. That was after his viewing of the documents in the various forms. He wasn't done with me. Any wide-ranging inquiries, such as advocated by Professor Scraton and some of the families I have spoken to, would clearly impose enormous burdens on the police, the emergency services, and the hospital and medical staff. But these burdens, in my judgment, would be to no purpose. This was the moment that I'd expected, the moment I'd anticipated. It was a moment that was devastating for the families who had gone down to the House of Commons to hope to hear that he would be bringing some of those contradictions out into the open once and for all. What they received was a complete abdication of responsibility. Of course, now it's absolutely clear. Lord Justice Stuart-Smith was not an appointment by accident. This was clearly the way in which Jack Straw, as the incoming Home Secretary, the Labour government returned after all those years of Conservative rule, could to some extent placate the families by saying, look what we've done for you, but then say, the status quo is preserved. And I can say that with full confidence now I've seen all the documents. Just to go back to the review and alteration, this is what it looks like. This is the way in which faxed across from the solicitors to Denton, each named police officer, 700 of them, the comments are made on them. They use the review and alteration comment in this front piece. In the immediate aftermath, it was decided that the usual regular form of taking statements from the police would not obtain. They were told not to write in their pocketbooks. They were given sheets of A4 paper, and they were sent away to handwrite their experiences, warts and all, of the day. This is what the front page of his statement looks like. It then gets typed up, and then the team, as you can see, the amount of edits that are just on that one page, the team go through and take out all of the contentious statements that he makes, particularly those directed against his senior officers. And then we have the final statement, pristine, as if it was the only statement that was ever taken. I said to him, after that last walk in Hathersage, but your signature is on each page. And he looked at me and he said, yes, it is my signature, but I didn't put it there. Who knew? This is how it worked. A few days after the disaster, a certain chief superintendent took us out for a drink. We were basically told, look, unless we all get our heads together and straighten it out, there are heads going to roll. My partner Dina is with me this evening, and she remembers this moment as well as I do, I'm sure. The night that I sat bolt upright in bed in the middle of the night from a deep sleep and shouted, they all knew. That was the moment in my sleep that the penny had dropped. The West Midlands Police Investigation Team, Lord Justice Taylor, the coroner, the Treasury Solicitor, the Home Office, they all knew. And I made that clear in Hillsborough The Truth all those years ago. The publishers were a little bit worried. But now we know they all knew. So what did I try to achieve in this desperation of the moment in 1999? By now I knew many of the families. I'd been to baptisms, and sadly, I'd been to funerals. I'd watched the families struggling for the truth and worked with them in the same way as many of the families I'd previously worked with on deaths in custody, and also the Dunblane families. That issue of injustice that really cuts to the depth of the pain and the suffering of bearing witness when you're directly involved. The book had to be written as an overarching account to contextualise Hillsborough, to demonstrate the dichotomy on the day of control versus safety, the endemic failures in the duty of care, the immediate circumstances of the disaster which nobody had traced, the failings in the rescue and evacuation, the treatment of the bereaved and survivors in that gymnasium. Yes, families arriving in Sheffield because they've not heard from their loved one, fearing the worst. They're put into an opened up, disused boys' club. They're held there until the early hours, many of them. They're bussed down to the stadium. They're wrapped in a blanket. They're taken inside. And there, on a screen, are Polaroid photographs of faces in body bags. In that situation, they're trying to identify their loved ones. Number 63, it could be. Number 63 in the body bag, wheeled on a trolley, not allowed to touch, not allowed to caress, not allowed to show any love for your child, for your husband, for your wife, for your father, for your mother. That's the identification process. That was a story that still is hardly known. In Hillsborough, the truth, I tell it not as voyeuristic. I tell it because that exemplifies the pain of death for me. That was the tragedy that came out of the disaster and the injustices that follow. The failure to prosecute and discipline. I argued, and I knew my way around the inquest procedure from my previous work. I argued about the institutional failure of the inquest procedure, the way it had been conducted, the verdict. I unpacked it brick by brick, if you can unpack something brick by brick. I examined for the first time the full review and alteration of police statements. And then in the 2000 edition, I added a chapter on Duckenfield and Murray. It's a great headline, how the truth was centred. It was censored, and I'm sure many of you think it relates to the publication of the Hillsborough Independent Panel report. It doesn't. It relates to the first publication of Hillsborough the Truth, serialised in the Sunday Mirror, how the truth was censored. Why did it take so long? Why did it take so long for the families to wait another 10 years before that issue, which had been so publicly proclaimed, actually came to pass? The conclusion of Hillsborough the Truth makes this final statement. Against the considerable odds of authorities' privileged access to formal procedures, their lack of accountability, and their continued unwillingness to acknowledge their responsibilities, the bereaved and survivors have maintained a dignified opposition. The sheer scale of physical and mental ill health and of premature death cannot be measured with clinical certainty. And the evidence presented in Hillsborough the Truth indicts a system that privileges the interests of the powerful over the rights of the powerless. When major institutions are under threat, however, it remains a system that sacrifices rather than realizes the principles of natural justice. How could I say anything other than that? For 10 years, I'd met families in their homes, in meetings, on the street. Eddie was top of my friends and family's BT list for 3 years. Would have made it a fourth, but he went on holiday. Eddie has since passed away. His son, who died in his arms. Eddie, early and one of the most vocal and most loved of all of the family members. What a cruel end, the early onset of Alzheimer's. Nothing will convince me that his death was not premature and brought on by Hillsborough. Like so many other, we talk about justice for the 96. There are many people in a whole range of different ways whose lives have been terminated early because of Hillsborough. The 20th anniversary. Andy Burnham, an MP from the North West, Minister of State for Culture and Sport, makes an address to the families at the memorial, invited by Margaret, who's here tonight. It was an inspired moment, and the thousands, the 35,000 people who were in Anfield that day, they were sceptical of that invite because this was the first time a politician had been ever allowed to address the memorial service. After all, it is a memorial service. And he made his address. And that evening, as the families were given the freedom of Liverpool, he committed to taking it further with his government. He bounced his government into a new process. And the Hillsborough Family Support Group wrote a proposition, Truth, Recovery, Acknowledgement and Resolution, with a little help from their friends. That document went to the Home Secretary, who agreed to an unprecedented appointment of the Hillsborough Independent Panel. The panel's terms of reference, oversight of full public disclosure of all government and publicly held documents and material, consultation with the Hillsborough families to ensure that the views of those most affected by the tragedy are taken into account. Most significantly, and I fought to ensure that this was in the terms of reference, the management and disclosure of all of those documents and their contents would not be given to anyone, including the Prime Minister, before they were seen by the families. That was essential. The recommendations for a public archive of the Hillsborough documentation. And then finally, another one of my classic elastic phrases is embedded in this. The publication of reports explaining how the disclosed information adds to public understanding of the disaster and its aftermath. Once that phrase, adds to public understanding, was in the terms of reference, it was elastic. We could include anything we considered appropriate to disclosure. The research was established. I managed and directed it, based at Queen's University in Belfast. The scope of the research was as wide as we could make it. We wanted to look at the context in which the disaster happened, going back to the late 70s, in terms of the ground and safety precautions, etc. We wanted to examine fully all the documentation around the circumstances and around then the longer term aftermath. That is the elasticity I'm talking about. A content analysis of all documents. Whilst there are 400,000 pages digitized, there were 2 million documents from over 80 different organizations that we had to deal with. We also, and I'd already highlighted this in Hillsborough the Truth, I never accepted that all those who died, died between 3 and 6 minutes, as the coroner had argued. Therefore, he'd imposed a cut-off on evidence at 3:15 on the day. My argument was, wherever people were in that pile, they might have had a chance to survive, because some of the people who were low down that pile did survive. You know, when people are lying on top of each other, you're in an air pocket, somebody else is forming a bridge over you, your chest wall does not become compressed, your lungs do not become trapped, you can still get a breath. That was the reality. I was always skeptical. I tried to persuade the families at the time of the inquest that they should go for a judicial review of the decision by the coroner to impose a 3:15 cut-off. But I was beaten down by their barrister. Technical process of the whole of the documentation, from hard copy originals like those you've seen to digitized versions. And then the methodology, adopting a methodology of documentary analysis, of cross references, of looking for gaps in the information. And of course, people, you would completely right if you say, how are you sure you didn't have access to all documents? Well, we didn't. In my younger days, I was a fairly serious mountaineer, and the concept of triangulation is finding out where you are from three different points. That's exactly the process that we adopted for this whole methodology, to find out the issues of where we were by looking at three different points if that particular document did not exist. And so the Hillsborough report was published in September 2012. We kept our word. The families heard it first. I was up for 2 hours on my feet presenting the report along with Bill Kirkup, the medic on the panel. This report went into the hands of David Cameron at exactly the same moment it went into the hands of the families. He only had that time while we were on our feet in the Anglican Cathedral in Liverpool to prepare his response for the House of Commons immediately afterwards. The institutional failings, the unheeded warnings, 1981 to 89, was absolutely paramount to establishing why the disaster had occurred. And we gained access to all information that previously had not been seen. The moment of 1989 is actually a chapter that looks at all of the documentation concerning the actual moment of the disaster. The emergency response and the aftermath, the medical evidence. We believe that if we got access to all the medical evidence, all the pathology reports, those who died could tell us something. And by goodness, they did. Investigating the investigations. We had to investigate the investigations of the West Midlands Police and others, to analyse the civil cases, to look at the coroner's inquiry in depth and why the inquest had failed so dramatically. We returned to the review and alteration of statements. And in what is now a really well-known chapter that was written on our kitchen table just 6 weeks before this report was published, when all of the information I'd sought for nearly 2 years finally arrived, we had to get behind the headlines, answer the one simple question: why was Kelvin McKenzie so confident that he could write that headline? He's not a stupid man. How could he write that headline? Who had pulled the strings? I got it slightly wrong. I thought it was three police officers. It turned out it was four. The testimony of the dead, and I'm only going to talk briefly now, selectively, about some of the findings. There are 153 key findings, some of which repeat and reiterate those from our earlier work. First of all, the panel systematic review of all individual records. And what we found, that the claim of the inevitability of all who died, that they could not be saved, was unsustainable. I'll never forget the day when we went through the pathological evidence, myself and Bill Kirkup, with an external assessor. And when we went through that evidence, all our worst fears were founded. Due to partial asphyxia, there was prolonged survival, and this was in their records, of 41 of the 96. In other words, relatively speedy intervention, being lain in the appropriate position, being carried by people who knew what they were doing, would have given them a very strong chance of survival. Of all my years working with the families, this was the hardest message to give. Standing in front of the families, 400, in the Anglican Cathedral, to deliver this message that some of your loved ones, and we think now, having looked at some of the other pathology in greater depth, that the majority of those who died would have had a real chance of survival. Then we moved on to the taking of blood alcohol levels and demonstrated how that evidence was flawed. Briefly, we did analysis of when each of those 96 people came into the ground and their blood alcohol level, and it didn't show there was an inrush immediately before the kickoff of drunken fans. If that 96 is taken as a random sample, which it is, because they came in roughly in three equal moments, before 2:30, between 2:30 and 2:45, and after 2:45. And what we found was the small, low-level alcohol distribution was equal between all of the groups. So this idea of an inrush of drunken people, if you take that as a random sample, was absolutely unsustainable. And we were able to make that argument statistically. We also wanted to uncover, and this was one of my personal commitments to the families, was how the dead, their loved ones, had been criminalised. The South Yorkshire Police interviews with the bereaved in the immediate aftermath, when they sat at those tables, having just identified their loved one, and they were asked questions about whether their loved one drank, whether they would have driven and drank, about whether or not they had a criminal record. Many people didn't believe the families when they said this. I always believed the families. It was quite self-evident that it had been persistent. The decision on the same day of the coroner to take blood alcohol levels of all who died. The South Yorkshire Police, and we now have a film of this, the South Yorkshire Police driving over the Snake Pass that links Lancashire and Yorkshire to look in lay-bys to find bottles or to find cans to try and suggest that somehow an uneven distribution of bottles and cans the next day in those lay-bys could somehow be connected to fans pulling into those lay-bys and drinking. I mean, it almost is beyond comprehension. Not because I wouldn't put it past them. That's not my point. It's beyond comprehension in terms of what a waste of manpower. It's absolutely no evidential quality at all. But then we found something else, which actually delivered the process of criminalisation even more. You can't read this very well from where you're sitting, but it is a list, handwritten list, of all those who died who had recorded blood alcohol levels. They investigated them to see if they had a criminal record. So this idea of constructing an image of those who died as criminals is absolutely consolidated by this investigation that occurs within days, taking the names of all who died, their ages, their addresses, and then checking, because they had even minimal blood alcohol levels, checking to see if they had criminal records. So that connection between criminality and what that's supposed to mean, because one of the, you know, they're just all low-level issues, and people having a recorded blood alcohol level. Let me put blood alcohol levels into perspective. I can tell you absolutely without any shadow of doubt, if you took a random 96 people going into Glyndebourne and you were to take their blood alcohol levels, they would average a far higher blood alcohol level than the handful of people who were not, who'd had too much to drive. Not who were staggering drunk, but who'd had too much to drive. Behind the headlines, this was what landed on the kitchen table just those weeks before. We finally got access to the news agency, White's News Agency in Sheffield. They were the people who had linked the South Yorkshire Police story to the national media. And they linked it with this series of faxes, which we finally received in 2012. These were statements made by police officers. They kicked and punched, they gave the kiss of life. They openly urinated on us and the bodies of the dead. Had the fans entered the ground in orderly and civilized manner, the crushing would not have happened. Picked the pockets of victims who were carried away. And in the middle of all of this was Sir Irving Patnick, Conservative MP within Sheffield, who turns up that evening and goes to White's. Unsolicited allegations made by high-ranking South Yorkshire police officers to agency partners. Four police sources supported by interview with Mr. Patnick. Verification for the story to be consolidated. And when the fans tried to object to this, this was the letter they get back from the managing editor of The Sun. He wrote, that to say that while regretting the presentation of the article, the Kelvin McKenzie article, he refused to apologise for its substance, stating it was factually accurate. At least five families received that through their letterbox on the day they were burying their loved one. And finally, what we were able to unpack was that on the day that Sun newspaper report came out, the Police Federation held a meeting at a cafe, in a restaurant in Sheffield. Police Federation wanted to put our side of the story over to the press and media. And in the middle of this meeting, something again unprecedented occurs. The Chief Constable walks in, the Chief Constable at a Police Federation meeting. The truth, he said, and it's here in the minutes, could not come from him, but he gave the Police Federation a free hand and his support. He said that the South Yorkshire Police case had to be pulled together and given to the inquiry, and events had to be prepared, a rock-solid story presented, and the force would be exonerated by the Taylor inquiry, and blame should be directed towards drunken, ticketless individuals. So, 24 years on, where are we now? The Prime Minister's double apology within minutes beamed live from the House of Commons to the families in the Anglican Cathedral immediately after we'd stood down from delivering the report. The Independent Police Complaints Review, now investigating 2,000 officers from 28 forces for police misconduct. A criminal investigation, potential criminal prosecutions of individuals and corporate bodies previously denied. The Attorney General High Court quashing the inquest verdicts with new inquest verdicts to start on the 31st of March. Chief Medical Officer reviewing the entire procedures in the Royal College of Pathologists in terms of training for mass events. The National Health Service Chief Executive, Emergency Services, Health Authorities, full review. But most importantly of all that is significant. The most important issue is that the families received this report and that there is now public acknowledgement that has gone from the condemnation of the families to broad support for the families, including the media response. And so, back to where I started. And this is my final tribute to the families, to the survivors, specifically to the families, but also to the families of others who are here tonight who understand this process only too well. And hopefully this is why so many of us are in the room and can lend that support to families. They found a way of speaking out. The men and women whose voices have now reached us decided that they could not live with themselves if they did nothing. They could not stain their lives by remaining silent. Of course, he's talking of Chile. They understood that if they witnessed this suffering inflicted on themselves or on others and did nothing, they were in some twisted way being turned into accomplices. They had to face the long nights when it seemed that nobody cared, when the darkness and apathy seemed to surround them, when their voices did not seem to receive the echo and the answer they needed. The echo and the answer in this particular case is profound, and it's there, and it's a tribute to every one of those families and survivors who fought for so long for justice, that the echo and the answer is shared by us all.
So I just want to say a profound thank you to Phil for a presentation that was so riveting that I completely forgot my duty as a chair and let it go on for a considerable time. But I think we all feel it was well worth it, well worth it. I'll just step aside now and hand over to Herman Ouseley, who has chaired the second part.
Well, thank you very much. And Phil, it's a tribute that I think most people here could have listened for several hours, and I know you wanted to speak for another few hours as well. But, we have got a lot of other people here tonight who have been in the same sort of struggle over the last 20 or more years. And what the families of Hillsborough have demonstrated and the story you just told us so eloquently in such a forensic way is that the struggle never ends. The struggle goes on. Even if you bring closure on a particular incident, there are so many other people who are affected in families. And so the struggle for justice never ends. And that's why an organisation like the Institute of Race Relations exists. It's a unique think tank. It's an organisation in struggle itself, struggle to have resources to do the sort of work we want to do. But supporting the struggles of people whose voices are never heard. We do so with our education materials, the sort of publications like Race and Class, in which you have published your work, and I hope that those of you who don't know about Race or Class or enjoy it, that you will take the opportunity tonight to purchase a copy over there and read the very fine words written by Phil, and indeed subscribe to get Race and Class on a regular basis to help the promote the understanding of the work that we do. But this voice of the unheard is quite an important role that we play in supporting community-led struggles. It's about those who are themselves fighting against the injustices in which we know go on. The story of Hillsborough is well known, and more stories are emerging. In the same way, the 24 years of struggle for justice which goes on today for the Hillsborough families, we've got someone like Doreen Lawrence still struggling for justice for Stephen as we speak now, 20 years on. Two or three of the murderers are still out there walking around the streets untouched by the law. And there is further investigation going on into the way in which new evidence has appeared with allegations of how character assassination of witnesses took place. Evidence was actually tampered with in the very same way. And these are matters which are now coming into the open. And we've seen many other cases of deaths in custody in which clearly there is a lot more, and we wish there were many Phils around who could carry out such investigative and forensic probing. We've got two such women tonight representing some of the many families who have gone through that struggle. There's Marcia, who is going to speak, hopefully, and tell us something about how the stories we've heard reflect in her own quest for justice. How does it relate to the issues in the case of your own, is it brother?
That's Marcia.
Marcia, can we hear from you first?
Yeah, I'm Marcia Rigg, and my brother is Sean Rigg, who died at the hands of Brixton police officers in August 2008. And I'm sure everybody in this room would have heard of the case. This, what I've just heard this evening, is so real, because I absolutely felt every word that Phil actually said. And this is the reality of what's actually happening. Even 24 years later, they're still doing it. We had cases where my family and myself really had to conduct our own investigation. We had no faith in the IPCC whatsoever, right from the very outset, within hours of Sean's death. And we went to Brixton Police Station. We saw the CCTV footage, the CCTV where Sean had actually died. We knew that there was CCTV that would have covered the spot where Sean had died. And within days, we were told by the IPCC that those cameras did not actually exist at all, where we knew that they did exist. And after our legal team, Hickman and Rose, and Garden Court and Inquest, we had a really strong legal team beside us, and we were able to view the CCTV footage. And Sean's death was actually captured on camera within a couple of weeks. So the family knew exactly what had happened to Sean. However, the IPCC had found that, you know, the complete opposite. We couldn't get the officers interviewed initially, and we were concerned about that because they were actually there at the time that Sean died. So we found it absolutely ludicrous that the IPCC didn't find it fit to ask them actually what happened. I mean, we had to make a complaint to the IPCC and to the police that they should be interviewed under criminal caution or under misconduct caution. And because we made that complaint, the IPCC were forced to issue what's called a Regulation 9 notice on the officers, and they were pressured. It took 7 months, unfortunately, but they were interviewed on the tapes, criminal and misconduct and caution. The family didn't get to actually get the full recordings of the tape until almost 4 years later. And we had to literally battle every step of the way. What we did get after about a year or so, I can't remember, was a summary of what the officers had said during their interview, which was just piecemeal. You know, I understand what Phil has said, where there's gaps, you know, you could, the evidence didn't join up, nothing didn't make sense, and it was just very frustrating for the family. They did so many things that I can't actually repeat all of them, you know, in this very short space of time. I will eventually actually write my book so you can see exactly what happened. The truth is on our side. But eventually, to cut a long story short, 4 years later, we did have an inquest. And because of the family's own investigation in managing to get eventually the disclosure, full disclosure, which was very difficult. We'd had spliced CCTV, we had, you know, medical evidence that was not there, we couldn't get, you know, there was so much things. And eventually, I would say we've got perhaps at least 90% of the evidence. Some is missing, notebooks, obviously, CCTV, you know, the important things that were literally clinched the deal, radio transmissions, they're still missing now, but they have to be there somewhere. They're there because there's all the documents that show that they would be there. And, you know, we brought the truth out in the inquest. And the jury gave a very damning narrative verdict, which found that the inactions or the actions of the officers more than minimally contributed to Sean's death. In my books, that's unlawful killing. The coroner, on a technicality, did not allow the jury to come with an unlawful killing verdict. Neither were they allowed to come with the neglect, which was extraordinary, and reluctantly the family had to, you know, agree with that. But we were so confident in the jury that we had, and they actually vindicated the family. On the back of that, we were, strategically, the family had conducted their own documentary. We were making our documentary, building up to the inquest. We knew the evidence, we knew exactly what happened, and we thought, we're going to show the IPCC up. You know, we were always two steps ahead of the police officers. And on the day that the verdict came out, on the 1st of August 2012, we also put online on YouTube a documentary called Who Polices the Police? And it was very, very powerful. And I think that triggered off the IPCC then commissioned for the very first time, independent criminologist who's in the room tonight, and I thank her so much because she listened to the family. We, you know, my legal team and the family showed, you know, all the family. We had the transcripts of the inquest, and she conducted her review along with a QC, James Lewis QC, and another gentleman, Michael, I can't remember his name, who was in the, from the NHS. And I think they saw exactly what we saw and found that the IPCC's report, initial report, which found that the officers did absolutely nothing wrong, in fact, they exonerated the police completely. And we could have actually judicially reviewed them, you know, 18 months after Sean's death, but our legal team and ourselves decided we wasn't going to judicial review them. We had no time to waste any more public funds. Let's show them up at the end. It's not the IPCC's investigation anymore. It's our investigation. And we won. And I'm so glad that we did that. And because now the IPCC are now reviewing their original investigation. And hopefully, I'm expecting that officers should be charged for the death of my brother.
Well done. Thank you for sharing that with us, Marcia, the strength of the family in fighting its way through the fog and coming out at the end, feeling it's not about triumphalism, it's about maintaining the struggle to get to the truth, to get justice. And Janet, can you share with us some of the same features that you heard tonight?
My brother Christopher died in 1998. They showed us 11 minutes of video evidence of him being dragged into a custody suite with his trousers down, fully unconscious, and the police officers leaving him to die on the floor for that 11 minutes. But the way that the police treated me when I went to that police station made me suspicious. And I couldn't believe what they were trying to tell me. But I'm glad I didn't, because it took 7 years later and we got that full 108 hours of video evidence. And on that video evidence, it says on there that these police officers shouldn't have beat Christopher up. They CS gassed him. They should have put him in a cell and projected him to go to sleep. Yeah, and they basically should have hid it all. And that is on that CCTV footage. And that is what's made me fight for as long as I have. Same type of thing as, you know, like the Hillsborough case. They tried to say that my brother died from having 4.5 parts of lager and choking to death. Yeah. They tried to say that he might have just fell unconscious in the back of a van. But I wouldn't have that made. And it wasn't until I'd read all the statements and I'd seen exactly what they were trying to cover up. But because I wouldn't be quiet, the police have attempted to intimidate me. They closed my brother's flat off for 6 weeks and they wouldn't let anybody in. They took his computer away. They took his, his cigarettes and whatsoever, trying to find something, you know, to justify the fact that he had died on their custody suite floor. That didn't work, so then they started working on me and my family. My other brother, they intimidated him. They did him with a fray, charged him with a fray, which absolutely petrified him. But I weren't having it, mate. They bent Christopher's clothes. They cleaned the van. They dry cleaned the officer's clothing. Blood tests weren't done. They cleaned blood in the van and whatsoever. I weren't having it. I knew when I were being followed. I told the PCA that I'd been followed and they said there's no evidence of it. Then I found out just in 2013 that these police officers had been following me. They had been keeping track of me. But we got to an inquest and we got an unlawful killing. And you would have thought that would have been it. Unlawful killing means somebody's responsible. And I really believed that this was going to be it. I believed in the criminal justice system until I realised that the Crown Prosecution do not want to prosecute police officers.
That's right.
Yeah?
That's right.
So my solicitor got the evidence that was needed to take these police officers forward. The Crown Prosecution set a case that they knew would fail. There's absolutely no way in this world would it have been successful. They took advantage of my lack of knowledge and my family's lack of knowledge and grieving and set a case that they knew that would never, ever be successful. I've got all the documents at home. They made a mockery of us, yeah? Basically saying it's all been a red herring. I've got the documents at home. But I carried on fighting. We took the case to the European Courts of Human Rights. And eventually we forced the government into a position where they had to admit that Christopher's death was inhumane. The fact that the police officers had been making monkey and chimpanzee noises while he was laid dead, yeah, that he was discriminated against. And his right to life had been denied. But it didn't stop there. Because they don't like people who stands up, yeah, do you know what I mean, stands for the rights and will not, you know, accept, do you know what the police are telling you? They then decided to add my brother's body. They swapped it for a 77-year-old woman. In 2000, when we thought we had a funeral for my brother and we buried his body, he was in a mortuary in 6 body bags. But this is the reality that's going on here, yeah? And even now they're trying to intimidate me because, once again, they're trying to give me the same rubbish as what they've given me before. But I'm not accepting it. There's corruption going on in this country. And they're taking advantage of grieving families. And it's only by letting people like you know that this type of thing goes on that we can be supported. It's not. It doesn't stop there with me. Thank you.
You've heard two very powerful testimonies there from Janet and Marcia and how they have been tenacious in seeking to get justice. Justice for victims who become the target of the police, who themselves are seeking to wipe away the guilt by blaming the victims for what has happened. There are many other experiences, I'm sure, in the room. I know two people who have already indicated they want to speak, but it's your moment now to either ask questions, and we're not necessarily looking for speeches because we won't have time to get everyone in. But certainly I'd like to call on, first of all, Phil Green, who was one of the witnesses. You were at Hillsborough, weren't you? I think it's quite important we could hear from what you would like to say at this point in time, please.
Well, firstly, can I say I'm absolutely amazed by the power of the people who have just spoken, as well as being so close to Margaret here. Amazingly strong people who I'm sure everyone will agree in the room inspire all of us. My part in Hillsborough was minor, but obviously it's something which psychologically is rather difficult to get over. I just wanted to say that 2 weeks ago in a hotel in East London, I had contacted the IPCC in an attempt to see if they could give me a copy of my statement I made in May 89 after, like anyone else, having been disgusted by the Sun headline, which I can't imagine how it was for you, Margaret, but just for somebody who supports Liverpool or any football supporter, was very, very, it still is very hard to take. So I contacted the IPCC a while ago, because I'm hoping to write a book as well, by the way.
Race and Class will publish all your books.
Thank you, I'll hold you to that. My attempt is to show how wonderful Liverpool supporters are, because we've suffered so much, not just with the horrific slurs from Hazel, as well as Hillsborough, but also from at the hands of this disgraceful Murdoch that we know was given a free rein by Margaret Thatcher in the 80s. Anyway, I won't go on too much. just to say, before I gave my, before I met with the IPCC instructors, I did make a point of saying to them, it was very polite, I did say, but before we start, I would like to just express my doubt that the integrity of the IPCC, and I think I'm speaking for many people, especially many Liverpool supporters, I don't think she was expecting that, really. But on reading my statement, which is quite bizarre, 24 years on, I was pretty horrified to see that they'd left out huge chunks, especially with reference to 1988, where I was in the stand, where my brother was in one of the pens in Leppings Lane, and 88, as Phil mentioned, is very, very important in what happened in Hillsborough. The police were well aware of what happened on the day, but when they opened the gates in 88, they made sure there were a line of police on horses blocking the tunnel, directing people to the other pens. This didn't happen in 89. Everybody, many people know in 81, Spurs fans could have been the victims, and the semi-final didn't take place until 87, I believe, because the ground was unsafe, and the ground didn't even have a valid safety certificate. But anyway, I'll get to the point. The statement, which was taken by the West Midlands Police, tried to claim that I referred to my fellow supporters as a mob of people. I mean, such an emotive use of language was deliberate. I did bring attention to the... I'm an English language teacher in a college in East London, and the use of language was very deliberate. I gave a statement in 89, but what I saw was a set of questions with, again, my signature at the end. I remember signing every page, yet there was only a signature at the end. And all of the questions were about, how much did you have to drink? Were you drinking in the ground? Did you see violence? The questions set by the police have to be questioned. But fortunately, when I was going down the tunnel, a wonderful Liverpool man said to me, my friend, don't go down there, whatever you do. And he wasn't sure, so we came out and we went into the side pen. And probably I owe my life to him. But big respect to everybody in the room.
Thank you very much.
I know that Deborah Coles from Inquest wanted to say something, so please, it's your moment.
Thank you. I first just wanted to talk to what Phil said about speaking truth to power, and also about the significant role of families. We work at Inquest with the families of men, women and children who died in contentious circumstances, with a particular focus on deaths in all forms of custody, and indeed have worked with both Marcia and Janet. And one of the things that really strikes me, and still strikes me, today is the issue around accountability and the lack of accountability, and so many things that Phil, who's in fact a founding member of Inquest, so many things that he said during the course of his presentation just chimes true of the cases that we work, in particular the attempts very, very early on of the police, but of the media and others, to create an alternative narrative, try and deflect attention away from those people who are responsible for what's happened, and the real character assassination. And those of you who are following the Mark Duggan inquest, which is ongoing at the moment, will know only too well what I'm talking about. But just in the last 2 weeks, there have been two deaths involving young men, one black, one white, who've died following the use of restraint by police when they were being detained under the Mental Health Act. And I suppose the point I would say to this room is that this is ongoing. This is an extremely serious issue. And families absolutely need the support of everybody in this room and beyond, because what happens is suddenly families are thrown into the most protracted legal process, where the whole kind of inequality of arms comes up, just even difficulties in getting public funding to be represented by experienced lawyers to help navigate through a really complex process. A process that takes so many years, in which, and Janet I think said this very powerfully, in terms of the attempts of the state to try and really kind of run you down so that you have no kind of inner resources to carry on. And I think it's an absolute tribute to everybody who's spoken, and the kind of resonance from Hillsborough through to anybody who's fighting kind of state violence and injustice, that actually families do continue fighting, and they fight, and the reason they continue is because of the issues around speaking truth and for accountability, and there isn't accountability. And it was mentioned, Janet mentioned an unlawful killing verdict return on Christopher's inquest. There have been 10 unlawful killing verdicts, which means that inquest juries have decided that either excessive and unlawful force or neglect is cause of death, and yet there's never ever been a single successful prosecution. And I think that speaks something very, really speaks to the truth of how the state is allowed to kill. It's allowed to neglect people in state institutions across the country and not be held to account. And so, you know, thank you, all of you, but I mean, I think we all have a responsibility to ensure that families, that we walk alongside families in their kind of campaigns and struggles.
Thank you very much.
Anyone who would like to? Yes?
Thank you. Thank you for the brilliant presentation, Phil, and thank you guys. Following the cases of your brothers for quite a long time, so I'm more than familiar with the state injustice that is typical of your family in terms of the struggles and many other families. You know, over the last 30, 40 years, and as Deborah mentioned, the last time that any officer faced a charge in relation to death in police custody was in relation to the murder of David Oluwole in Leeds, who was effectively tortured for more than 10 years. He was a homeless man, mentally ill, who lived on the street of Leeds, and he was effectively tortured for more than 10 years by police officers who regularly abused and assaulted him, and then he was dumped in the river at the end of that. But then the officers only faced minor charges. You know, they didn't face charges for manslaughter, for murder. It was minor charges, and that is the last time. And we have countless numbers of deaths in custody, countless, okay? And I think it's very apt that this is hosted by race and class, because that is at the heart of the issue here. It is race and class, it is non-white people, it is powerless poor people who suffer the most, and it's their voices that are heard the least. And I think it's, I mean, just to pick up on a point that Phil made, which I think was quite crucial in terms of the more recent developments in the late 90s, was when he came across this police officer with a conscience who wanted to give the information. And yes, I know that the main part of the struggle was the commitment of the family and the family campaigns, and of course from people that were working closely with the families. But now, I just want to link that to the failure of the IPCC, mm-hmm. because the IPCC is run basically by ex-police officers, right? And what you need there, I think, is a contradiction, because you need a police officer with a conscience. And I think it's a very rare breed, right? Okay, yeah, and actually, I think in Ken Follow's film, I'm not sure if it was the police, it might have been, but Deborah Glass said in that film, she said that we don't have any loyalty to these families. She used that phrase, right? Okay, and now this is the key to it, okay? And now what is needed here is a radical change, because what came before the IPCC was a complete failure. The IPCC is a complete failure. What
just
is,
the same?
What is needed is a complete radical change, okay? A body that is made up of no police association whatsoever. That is what is needed, okay? And we can't have a future body that's similar to the IPCC that has ex-police officers. There's this nonsense that only the police can investigate. The police. That simply isn't true, and that has to change. We need a radical change, not just another new IPCC in a couple of years' time. So thank you.
At the back, please.
Hi, my name's Justin. I'm also very familiar with the speakers about deaths in custody. I'm really just overwhelmed, really, even though I've heard some, I know some of these stories quite well. I'm still overwhelmed with emotion, just thinking about how much tenacity, how much strength the families had to endure and to have in reserve to fight the state, to get some semblance of justice. And that's what they have at the moment, just an indication of justice, of truth. And what has happened in these cases, and with Hillsborough, and in the deaths of in custody that we've heard about tonight. It shows that, you know, the contempt, really, of the state, of those with power, the contempt that they have for ordinary working class people, whether they are of migrant background or if they are born and quote-unquote British. And what it shows is a truth about our society, about how, regardless of how these deaths have occurred, whether it's an accident, whether it is through malicious actors, if there is a cock-up at best, the state moves in into conspiracy to cover up what has happened. And for those who want justice, those who are powerless, those who are below, are denied it systematically. And with Hillsborough, we see it's not just at the level of police. It's at the level of not only judges, but also the leading politicians, even the Prime Minister, supposedly the most powerful person in the country. But actually it goes beyond that, because we look at Murdoch, we look at the role of international corporations and media institutions. Sorry, I'm kind of like struggling to deal with my emotions here. But the lies that they told of those families was easy to make, because of the great British tradition of denigrating and demonising migrants. Those people from Liverpool are not only just working class, there's an Irish tradition, and the British have a tradition of denigrating them. And that's why it's easy for them, for those lies, people ridiculous, ridiculous to be published on the major newspapers, to be accepted as fact, to be unchallenged for so long. But that, again, as Deborah has said, we've seen it happen with Mark Duggan. We've seen it happen with so many families. And okay. Why does it continue? It continues because those who are without power aren't able to determine how we get justice. We're not able to. But what I'm really grateful for is through this Hillsborough Independent Panel, and what's happened through almost chance, the fact that there was someone born in Liverpool who was the culture secretary, who came to the 20th anniversary. The fact that happened, and easily could not be, I mean, easily Burnham could have decided not to have gone. That's what created that opportunity for the families who've been fighting for so long to get this truth. And so what I think is needed, and what I think we can take from this, is that, one, we can't trust the state to represent us, to get justice for us. What we can look at, what models we can look towards, is what happened with the Hillsborough panel. That from below, the families determined and defined how truth would be brought about, how they could recover it. And that is something that we need to develop in all of our communities, where there are deaths in custody, where there are injustice involving the state. It can't be something that we call on politicians to create for us. We must build it for ourselves. And yes, there will be some negotiation with power. As I know, there was a former police officer on the independent panel. But the fact that the families were able to get the information before the Prime Minister, or at the same time at the very least, I think indicates the sort of struggles that we need to build towards to get some semblance of truth, and then hopefully some justice.
I'd like to say to all of you, oh, by the way, it's Margaret Aspinall. I'd like to say to all of you, it's not easy fighting for truth and justice. It's a hard, hard struggle. As these lovely ladies know here, they're still fighting to get justice for their brothers. I understand that, as Sue does here, who lost her brother. But we've got to all remember, it does not come alone. It does not come with just the families. It comes, what that guy there said, it comes with the support of our fans that day. We had 24,000 witnesses there that day. It comes with our survivors, who were the real heroes of that day. It comes about, when you talk about truth, it comes about the likes of this guy here. We need a lot more like this man in this world who will fight for truth and will fight for integrity and will fight and stand by the people who rightfully deserve it. Without the likes of Phil, Phil will understand if I say he's not the only one. We've got a lot of other people alongside us now. But it suddenly come when we got the truth on the 12th of September, our city in 1989, our city stood alone. It was on its own. Nobody believed the families. Nobody believed the fans or the survivors. They were just football supporters. They were nothing. They don't tell the truth. Now, I'll go back, if I may, to and say to all of you, when I was a child, my mother had 11 children. And we were taught and brought up that the country owes you nothing. When you are born, you have to work for your living. I believe that way. My mother used to always have a great saying as well, which I couldn't understand at the time, is you work hard, you treat people how you want to be treated, no matter what colour, what culture, what race, where you come from. Treat human beings how you expect to be treated. And I believe in that. But she had a funny saying she used to say to me, and not the rest of the children, my siblings, give me a thief before a liar. I couldn't understand what she... I used to think, give a thief before a liar. And my mother used to always say to me, if you ever lie to me, I will punish you. If you tell me the truth, even if you've done a little bit of wrong, I will not punish you. And I couldn't understand that at the time. But at least a thief, you know, I realise now, if somebody's a thief, you can say that guy's a thief or that woman's a thief. But a liar will tell a lie after lie to blame other people. And they cover that lie up and it goes beyond the scope of where it started. That's what the families have had to put up with. The families were telling the truth for all them years. And we fought against them lies. The mud was still getting flung and flung and flung. And we had to keep trying to scrape it off. But the worst part of all, as Phil will tell you, is the way them 96 were treated, even in their deaths. They treated them. I don't want to go into it. It was appalling. There's still more to Hillsborough than what's even been told. There's families who have died within, tormented. As Phil mentioned before, Eddie, I can mention Sue, her mum and dad. There's a lot of other families who, Joan Traynor, who lost her two sons at Hillsborough, her two lovely sons, died tormented without seeing the truth after she fought for so long. It's not about individuals. It's about a whole lot of people. And it's about us getting the support from behind like these two ladies here need. They will always need that support. It might take you 25 years. It might take, but never, ever, ever give up. You will always get because always remember this, no matter who's in power, we have the power to put them out. We have the power to change bad laws. And we will do it if we all stick together, the ordinary people. If they stick together, they will do it. We got told we'd never be able, ever, ever be able to quash an inquest verdict, especially on 96 people. We've achieved that. We've achieved that through the likes of guys like Phil, the people like Andy Byrne and Jimmy McGough, and all the good people of our city and beyond now who are helping us, and we will get accountability. We'll never get the justice for 96. You'll never get, there's no justice for the loss of your brother. What will give you justice? but there's got to be accountability. Somebody should be held responsible
Correct.
For the deaths of them. Until that happens,
Correct.
We will no, never yes. give up.
Yeah.
Put it better than Margaret has just done. I think we've heard some huge testimonies here tonight in search of truth and justice, of people who are tenacious in the fight, and we mustn't overlook the fact there are many others who've been defeated in that battle. People who have lost their loved ones and they haven't had the strength or had the backup to mount the campaigns to get towards even the level at which you've got to get close to getting to the truth and exposing the perpetrators, i.e. the police, the judicial system, the state apparatus that has denied those individuals justice. And as Margaret has rightly said, justice will only start to emerge when we see prosecutions of police officers, when we see prosecution of the people who are responsible for perverting the course of justice. And there are so many instances now where inquests have thrown up verdicts of unlawful killing. And we have to see prosecutions of those who are responsible. Until we start to see that, the battle remains entrenched in trying to get to a point where people can bring some closure and move their lives on. But it is an ongoing struggle. You said, Margaret, we cannot give up. And part of what we do at IRR, the Institute of Race Relations, is to try to be there to provide a body of support. And we do so with your support and with the many families and supporters out there who are struggling to come to terms with these deaths, deaths in custody, and also the way in which the police operate. Now, in conclusion, I know Phil wanted to come in early. I know one or two other people wanted to come in. But did you want to say any final words, Phil?
I think my only concern at the moment is one that I kind of live with every day, and it is the concern that you end up steering back to the same criminal justice system that put us in the position in the first place. And my concern is that, yes, of course, to some extent the police need to investigate the police, but what I am really concerned about in the process as it still stands, and it was something that we were free from in terms of the Hillsborough Independent Panel, is that I don't see the independent research, I don't see the independent presence of analysing the material that is now evolving out of their investigations. And it isn't that the police necessarily, I think they know the eyes of the world are watching them in this particular case. Over 130 police officers have been recruited to carry out the current investigations. And what I'm concerned about is the lack of independent oversight. And that independent oversight has to come from outside. It has to come asking different kinds of questions. And I've made my feelings very, very clear to the Home Secretary, and I've made my feelings very clear to the investigators and to the IPCC, that without that, they will never win the trust, of the public. They will never have the confidence of the public. And it's not that there will necessarily be deliberate crude cover-ups, it's that they bring a totally different vision, a totally different way of seeing to the table than did the Hillsborough Independent Panel. And I think that that whole process of having those kinds of questions asked by a range of professionals who have a critical view, have a critical lens, supported by researchers who are outside of the usual processes, who in my case were appointed by our university to work alongside me. That process is about bringing the analysis away from the usual suspects, and I think that's my biggest concern still. But as Margaret and Sue will tell you, I'm always a glass half empty person, and I think I've got, you know, after hearing tonight's testimonies, and I know both of these cases, as many others of the deaths in custody cases prior to it, I think I have every right to be a glass half empty person. And while we don't have that kind of independent oversight being brought to the table from outside of the usual avenues, I'm always suspicious that the outcome will not deliver the justice that we really have aimed for. But thank you all very much for tonight.
I would like to give you a final few words.
Like what Margaret said about sayings that your mother left. There's a saying that my grandmother gave me, God rest her soul, and that was, the truth is like oil on water, because the truth will always rise to the top. Oil and water does not mix. Lies and the truth does not mix. The truth will always rise to the top. And that's what we have on our side. Okay?
Janet? And I'm going to finish by saying that I am fed up of meeting gutless people, do you know, within the police, within the IPCC, that are there to protect themselves, there to protect their colleagues. Fear of standing up and putting their heads above the pulpit. Fear of, you know, their families, living off the pain of our families to keep their families. I'm fed up of seeing this. I want to see some more independence, and it's up to us to fight for it.
Thank you.